It's kind of another bit of a hard message. I really just started putting it together Thursday, but then really Saturday, so I may have to rely on my notes more. From a speaker standpoint, I like to have it here. You know, this is where it's most important that it comes from, not just here, but, you know, with my memory the way that it is, sometimes getting these two to connect are a little bit challenging. So, you know, what I've seen in the past, though, is that whenever a speaker is speaking from his heart, it's hard to really take all that in if, you know, they're relying a lot on notes. I just say that, you know, you guys may not be that way, but the things I want to talk to you about this morning are so near and dear to my heart. Some of them will be hard, some will be challenging, but yet if we will step up to the call, man, we can see God do things more incredible than you could ever imagine that you would see him do. So anyway, y'all bear with me on that, and let's just see what God has in store. More importantly, let's do what God wants us to do. You know, I'll be the first to admit, I have to repent because of some of my frustration with the community. Man, God really began to gently and lovingly convict me about my attitude toward this community that we live in. I love Jesus. I love him very, very much. But Jesus loves Griffin, regardless of how bad it is. But here is the things that I've struggled with and what God is calling us to do as a church. You know, this is one of the most frustrating things about this community. There are a lot of parents in our town that worry about sending their children into our public schools. They're worried that they will get entangled in drugs or some other destructive habit. You know, what it boils down to is that our children are exposed, and a lot of them, the only protection they have is the time it takes for a first responder to get to and respond to an emergency call for that child or for that family. But my question is, where is the church? Specifically, where is Lasting Impact in all of that? What can we do? You know, there was a man named Nehemiah who was faced with some very similar circumstances. Nehemiah lived in a time where walls, large, tall walls, would surround a city, and that's what protected the city's inhabitants. That's what protected the sons and the daughters and the moms and the dads and the grandparents. But Nehemiah had a problem. The people that day had a problem. That wall was lying in ruins. The gates were rotten on their hinges. The wall was filled with large gaps everywhere, and so Nehemiah had a problem. But Nehemiah did something about it. The first thing Nehemiah did is that he acknowledged the problem, and then he wept over it. He fasted and he prayed, but then more importantly, he got off of his butt and he did something about the problem. We can read about his acknowledgement of the problem and his response and his prayer in Nehemiah chapter 1. And Kathy pulled up on the screen in Nehemiah chapter 1 and verses 3 and verses 4. And I want you to notice, though, Nehemiah didn't use prayer as an excuse as I've done my part. He did something about the problem that was affecting the people that he loved in his community. And my heart is, we'll do the same. I love your children. I love your family. I love Jesus. And I want some of these people in our community to see how awesome and powerful it is to be a fully devoted follower of Jesus. And we are the ones that can go out and show that to this community by expressing faith in love. You know, the way that we studied about in small group. But Nehemiah chapter 1 verse 3, Nehemiah acknowledged the problem. He didn't do like some of our leaders in our community and some of even our Christian leaders and stick his head in the sand and ignore it. He acknowledged the problem. Verse 3, they said to me, those who have survived, this is moms and dads and families, those who have survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates have been burned with fire. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. That is my heart for us. Man, I want us to weep over the condition, the moral and the spiritual condition of our community. The fact that they are without the protection, the intercession that they need. So many people in Griffin are. Nehemiah sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. But Nehemiah didn't stop there. He'd done something about it. Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 17. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble that we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." It is no secret that our city is often a disgrace on the public news, and that we are lying in ruins. But we, as followers of Jesus, if we'll realize that it's so much more than just about us or just about sitting in that chair for an hour and then leaving, we can do something about this problem, and we don't have to put up with our town being in disgrace and our sons or our daughters being in the danger that they are faced with. We can do something about this. We can pray and acknowledge the problem. We can fast and weep, you know, we can intercede, and then we can get up and rebuild the walls and restore the dignity to our town and to some of the churches in our community. But we have to acknowledge it, and we have to be broken by the things, unlike I was just a few weeks ago, to be honest with you, just frustrated and almost embarrassed to say that I lived in Griffin. You know, God has dealt with my heart about that, and I pray He does the same for you. Look, I have a heart for people that are far from Jesus. I would much rather hang out with a sinner sometimes than I would a follower of Jesus, because sometimes followers of Jesus, not all, but sometimes Christians are not pleasant to be around. And it's just more natural to be around somebody who is not following Jesus. Not because you want to become like them, because you love them and you want to pull them into a relationship with Jesus. But as far as a community, you know, God dealt with my heart about it and began to, after, you know, the leadership team done some fasting and praying, just begin to stir things within our heart. Nehemiah did something about the problem after he acknowledged it, and after he fasted and prayed. He did more than just that, though. He went out. He left a place of prominence and protection, the king's palace where he was, and went in and entered into the suffering of the people in order to help them out. And God invites us, encourages us, and has empowered us to do the very same thing. Let's start doing it. You know, bottom line is that Griffin has been disgraced long enough. You know, our children have been in danger long enough, and Lasting Impact Church has distanced itself from these problems far too long. Let's make a difference. Let's start doing something about it. And look, if you don't believe that God can do it, you don't know the God that I know. With man, it seems impossible, but with God, everything is possible. If we will get our priorities straight, not just me, you guys, we can make a huge difference in this county. But bottom line is this: right now, we're not making a difference. Out of 536 towns in this state that are incorporated, Griffin is the 10th most dangerous city in this state. There are, within a 10-mile radius, there are several large, wildly popular and growing churches, and yet we're still one of the most dangerous cities in this state. We've got to do something different. And what's so bad is that most of the people in our community have a bad taste in their mouths toward Christianity and toward the church and toward Jesus, because sadly, not all, but too many of us have given them a reason and confirmed negative biases against, you know, Jesus. But we can do something about it. What is holding us back right here in this church are three things. I'm not going to go overboard with them. Number one, a lack of prayer. We're not praying the way that Nehemiah prayed. We're not broken over our town and our community the way that Nehemiah was. But look, that affects your sons and your daughters and your mom and your grandparents. It's not just a community. I pray that we make it personal, but we've got to get a heart for it and start praying. Secondly, is a lack of finances. Finances are crippling us, and it costs money to go out and to do events where we, you know, connect in the community. But God's given us some ideas that will require very little of that. And then the third thing is a lack of help from our church family. Those are the three biggest obstacles we're facing right now: lack of prayer, lack of finances, and lack of help. But we can make a difference. It does not have to be that way. After fasting and after praying, we've sought God wholeheartedly, and there are three areas in this town that we can make a difference, and we can change the culture of this community. The first one is gangs. There's no doubt that there is a problem with gangs. You talk to Ray Hightower, you talk to some of the other law enforcement, there are gang problems, and there are things that are preventing them from being able to, Ray Hightowers and the other officers and deputies, from being able to do anything about it. As a church can be a voice, for those people. We can intercede the way that Nehemiah interceded, not only for law enforcement, but also, we can be a voice to the politicians. The second area where we can help is we can continue to assist, come alongside and assist the teachers in reaching some of those kids. But see, we had to stop that because we didn't have the money to continue doing it, but that is something we are going to start back doing, and I'm believing with all of my heart God is going to provide the funding in order to get into those schools and, more importantly, get into those hearts of those teachers, because our motive ultimately, not going to lie, is to build relationships, gain trust, and lead them to Jesus and show them how awesome and amazing Christ is. And the third area that we're going to make a difference in this community is drugs. We can initiate programs that will prevent drug use. We can, help, Officer Pike. As far as I know, that's one of the only prevention programs here, one man in a nice car. But the church can do so much more coming alongside with some of these leaders who have the potential to make a difference, but we've got to get out of that seat and go out in our community and do it. But you got to get a heart for it. Sometimes we got to rearrange our priorities. We can not only do drug prevention, but we can also do intervention. There are things that we as a church can do, and not everybody is open to the message of Jesus Christ who is seeking help to overcome drugs, and that's totally okay. We don't have to neglect those, but there are things right now that we have in the works that we're researching and putting together so that we can make a difference in those three areas that are plaguing our community. We can make a difference here, but we have to get off of our butts and sometimes climb down off of a religious high horse and go out and express love through faith more than just the people inside this church. Express that love through faith, outside of our Christian bubble to those who are not on a Christian island. We sometimes, separate ourselves on. We can make a difference. But it's going to take every one of us working together. It's going to take every one of us doing things outside of Sunday morning. It can't be just one person. It can't just be me or Brandy or, it has to be us as a church family, because, look, your families are some of the families that we want to intercede for and want to make a difference in their lives. We can make a difference in this community if we work together as a team, but we have to work together. There's a story about a captain of large ships. Captain of a large ship and his chief engineer were arguing over who was most important to the ship. To prove their point to each other, they decided to swap places. The chief engineer went up to the bridge and the captain went down to the engine room. Several hours later, the captain suddenly appeared on deck, covered with oil and dirt. "Chief!" he yelled as he's waving a monkey wrench. "You gotta get down here. I can't make her go." "Of course you can't," replied the chief. "The ship has run aground." You know what? We can make a difference. And it's not about one person doing this, another person, not about who has the most important job. It's about working together to achieve greatness in this community and to promote the love of Jesus Christ. Like the acrostic says, together everybody can achieve more. And spell it out, that says team. It's going to take working together as a team, but we can make a difference if we'll, stop worrying about, it's the pastor's job, or it's this person's job, or that person has it. But if we will work together and realize that every one of you have an important role, and it is, whether you're down in an engine room making something go, or you're up on a deck, or you're behind the scenes, it doesn't matter. Your part is critical if we're going to make a difference. We're never going to make a difference if we don't get out of our seats and do something. But before we do that, we got to have a heart for Jesus. And we got to have a heart for the condition of our children. Look, man, we can go out and we can rescue our children from the crack dealer. We can prevent our child, your daughters, you know, my daughters, my granddaughters coming up from sacrificing their virginity to a meth dealer to obtain drugs. That's about as real as it gets. That's a possibility in this town and in this area. That is your kids. And it, you know, I love Jesus, and I pray every one of my children do, but I'll take all the prayers and all the help that I can get, and that's what I'm asking you to do. We can make a difference together, working together, and we can prevent, you know, some of those things from happening. Then there's moms and dads and aunts and uncles out there so strung out and so messed up that families are losing hope. But we have a hope that does not disappoint, and His name is Jesus. And His Holy Spirit can and will overpower anything that stands against your family or mine. But we have got to close the gaps, because around Griffin there are walls broken down, metaphorically speaking, large gaps the enemy can penetrate. The gates are rotten on their hinges, and these dope heads, these gangbangers, and everybody else are coming in and wreaking havoc in our schools and in your kids' lives and mine. But we can do something about it if we will work together. We can really make a difference, but it takes us working together. I'm asking for your help beyond Sunday mornings, not just in this building. Yes, we need volunteers here on Sunday mornings, because there'll be people coming in as a result of our efforts, but we need your help, you know, beyond Sunday mornings in doing some of these things. There is nothing on this planet that compares. I've you know, had a business for a long time. There was, you know, times I didn't make anything. There was times I made more money than I ever, you know, have seen since. You know, sadly, I spent more than I made, but you know, I know what it's like to have the satisfaction of being self-employed and making a lot of money. But you know what? I make very, very little right now, but I'm more satisfied than I've ever been in my entire life. When you do the work of God, when you find out what your purpose is, and you join a team and you work together and you see a person rescued out of darkness, there's nothing that compares to that, and you can be a part of it. And that's what I'm asking you to do this morning. We can make a difference, but each one of us have to do something. There's nothing more heartbreaking for a pastor than to preach his heart out or teach his heart out, and people get up and go out on Sundays and never do anything about it. Look, man, we exist for so much more than that. I love our building. I love all this equipment and, you know, our children. And I love what goes on here. It's so much more than 1 hour on Sundays. Please get that and understand that. You know, sometimes things don't go right for us because we have our priorities. Realign them and work for God and make a huge difference. You know, I'm going to read a story. Some of you will remember it from a while back. This is what my heart is for each one of us. The story is told during the bombing of a city in World War II. A large statue of Jesus Christ was severely damaged. When the townspeople found the statue among the rubble, they mourned because it had been a beloved symbol of their faith and of God's presence in their lives. Experts were able to repair most of the statue, but its hands had been damaged so severely that they could not be restored. Some suggested they hire a sculptor to make new hands, but others wanted to leave it as it was, a permanent reminder of the tragedy of war. Ultimately, the statue remained without hands. However, the people of the city added on the base of the statue of Jesus Christ a sign with these words, "You are my hands." We can go in this community and be the hands and the heart of Jesus and show a lost and a dying world trapped in darkness, feel like they're dying in pits, the hope of Jesus Christ, a hope that will not disappoint. Are you willing to be the hands and the heart of Jesus? Or would you, knowing what's going on in our community, would you take the same route that some other church people did in this story? I lived in Germany during the Nazi Holocaust. I considered myself a Christian. I attended church since I was a small boy. We heard the stories of what was happening to the Jews, but like most people in today in this country, we tried to distance ourselves from the reality of what was really taking place. What could anyone do to stop it? A railroad track ran behind our small church, and each Sunday morning we would hear a whistle from a distance and then the clacking of wheels moving over the track. We became disturbed when one Sunday we noticed the cries coming from the train as it passed by. We grimly realized the train was carrying Jews. They were like cattle in those cars. Week after week, the train whistle would blow. We would dread to hear the sound of those old wheels because we knew that the Jews would begin to cry out to us as they passed our church. It was terribly disturbing. We could do nothing to help those poor, miserable people, yet their screams tormented us. We knew exactly at what time that whistle would blow, and we decided the only way to keep from being so disturbed by the cries was to start singing our hymns. By the time the train came rumbling past the churchyard, we were singing at the top of our voices. If some of the screams reached our ears, we'd just sing a little louder until we could hear them no more. Years have passed and no one talks about it much anymore, but I still hear that train whistle in my sleep. I can still hear them crying out for help. God, forgive us, all of us who call ourselves Christians, yet do nothing to intervene. Their screams tormented us. If their screams reached our ears, we would just sing a little louder. This morning, you have a choice. What, as Kevin O'Leary would say, what are you going to do? You have a choice. You can go out and be the hands of Jesus, or you can sing a little louder. What are you going to do? You've got a decision to make. You can be the hands and the hope, or you can sing a little louder and continue to distance yourself from the cries, or we can make a difference and rescue people in this community and make a difference in ongoing efforts. We can and will see this culture. It's your choice. What are you going to do? Be his hands or sing a little louder? I'm going to pray, and the band's going to come. I'm going to do it differently this morning. After I get through praying, I'm going to ask you if you are willing to help, if you are willing to stand in the gap and intercede and close those gaps for our community. I want you to come down here, and I want you to pray with me this morning, and I want you to say, you know what, I am willing to not only pray, but I want to make a difference, because chances are you know somebody that is struggling in this community. Let's go out and be the hands and the heart of Jesus and stop singing louder and ignoring the problems. Father, thank you for Jesus. I pray, Lord, that you will help us to show people the heart of Jesus. Father, I pray that you will help us to show our faith by expressing it in love to people who are hurting and dying, Lord. I pray that, Holy Spirit, that you will convict us, Lord, of the things that are holding us back from experiencing the life that you desire for us, Lord. Because when we do these things, Lord, not only do others benefit, but we are blessed as well, and we encounter great things. Holy Spirit, I pray that you will move on the hearts of people and that we will respond this morning. I pray that, that people will move out of where they are and come down and join us, Lord, and say, okay, I will make a stand. I am declaring publicly I will be the hands of Jesus. Lord, we love you and praise you. And if there's anybody in here that does not know the heart of Jesus but is seeking and searching, would you save that person this morning? And would you set them on fire? And would you give them a purpose, Lord, and a passion for you? God, we love you and praise you. I just place it in your hands now. In Jesus' name, amen. How do you
love that goes from east to west. It runs as deep as it is wide. You know all our hopes. Lord, you know all our fears. And words cannot express the love we feel, but we long for you to hear. So listen to our hearts. Hear our spirits sing a song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. We will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. Words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to our hearts. If words could fall like rain from these lips of mine, and if I had 1,000 years, I would still run out of time. So if you listen to my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the life, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. So listen to our hearts, hear our spirits sing a song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. The words are not enough to tell you of our love, so listen to our hearts.
Father, thank you for everybody who stepped out and said, I will help, I will be your hands, and I'll show people your heart. Father, I pray that this town and this community will see the hope of Christ in and through us, Lord. Father, I pray that you'll continue to carry us to a place where we can make a difference in not only the community, but in an individual's life. God, we love you, we thank you. We praise you. We ask for your continued guidance, your continued provision, and everything we'll need to show this town how amazing you are. We love you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Guys.